Less than 24 hours ago, we had our big conference with close to 700 people attending the TUC headquarters in Oslo. For the first time, we had the Oil Workers Union present on the platform, the leadership of the TUC. The topic was a just transition away from oil. Is it possible? And I'm just going to, the snippet is just this, we're having a workshop on it later. The snippet is this, that even the oil workers who have lost 40,000 jobs in the oil exporting Norway for the last couple of years, they understand climate change, but they will not go from stable, secure jobs to temporary jobs working as a carpenter. They are literally begging us to make the climate jobs program a reality, to build enough force from below to make sure that the transition is planned. So there are so many difficulties in coming to climate change, but yesterday, to me, with, you know, like 700 people discussing this, with the electricians union, the digital workers union saying that we can create a better picture of the future, it's all about making the program for climate jobs a reality. We can't pull the entire trade union movement with us within the next couple of years. I saw it, it can happen yesterday, but we need to make sure that the job creation plans coming from new government are serious, dead serious, because they are fed up with talk about new jobs. It needs to happen.
Before you yourself.
I'm sorry, my name is Andreas Ytterstad. I'm vice chair of the Concerned Scientist in Norway. I wrote the 100,000 climate jobs pamphlet 5 years ago, which prompted the Bridge to the Future Alliance, which is happening in Norway.
Brilliant. Thank you. I'm glad because it's a smaller country, not because we don't want to know the climate jobs. Am I? Yeah, okay. Maybe to a woman in the yellow. Thank you. Just for the thing, and then yourself. And thank you, everybody, for staying within a minute. If you have the mic, we'll work on that one.
Yeah, no, I really agree with what Asad was talking about climate change happening now and not affecting everybody equally. I think it's also important, though, to think about the deep inequality even within the global north. You look at America, that's partly what fueled, you know, with Trump playing on some of that. And you think about the vivid example of Hurricane Katrina when that happened and how it was the poor and black people who were left. You kind of see the people that are the least responsible, even in the north, also affected the most. It made me think about it. It's a bit of a question about the beast from the east, because that's to do with climate change and the polar vortex. But if you think about here, again, who's affected by that? People who can't afford to put on their heating, or people on the streets? These are integrated questions, aren't they? That inequality here means people who didn't affect climate change are affected more. And that's why I think it is really important that trade unions are part of organising people wherever in the world. Actually, the people affected most against the people that you're also up against, probably the low wages, the bad conditions, and at the same time, those same big corporations are the most responsible for climate change. But I think we've just got to understand that inequality exists, not just north and south in the globe, but within what are meant to be rich countries. Actually, they're deeply unequal.
Thank you. So you take yourself, but can I see, right, okay. So next step after yourself, I'm going to take the guy who stood up at the back, I'm going to take yourself, then I'm going to take the guy here waving at me, yes, and you, and then I'll take one more, 1 second. Can I then take you? Okay, and then I'll come back and see if we can sit for 1 minute, we'll see what we can do. Off you go.
A Paul Allen Zero Carbon Britain project. We're absolutely right, we have to get to zero by mid-century. One of the tools that we can offer is we've done detailed modelling of how we can actually get the UK to zero emissions, hour by hour modelling, 10 years worth of real data, looking at powering down energy demand, powering up renewables. It's all there, free of charge for people to use, which we've put over there. But the crucial thing is that recognition, it's not a technology challenge, it's a social and cultural challenge. And the key aspect is that we're coming to the first of three facilitative dialogues with the part of the Paris Ratchet mechanism. The initial pledges were nowhere near enough. The world will warm to 2 or 3 degrees at least. We need to work with the Paris ratchet mechanism. There's three chances for nations to increase their ambition. The first one is this year in Poland. What are the global unions doing to work to increase their ambition and raise the profile of COP24? It's more pivotal than Paris.
Thank you. And thank you for raising that issue of COP24 and what's the future for us in terms of Poland, the Polish COP.
Okay, so I've got a question for Joanna and for Barry. So as I was talking about the effect that so many of the scenarios that the scientists are talking about are based on assuming that there will be these net negative emission technologies put into place, bioenergy, carbon capture and storage and the like. And what I'm worried about is that the scientists are basically hiding these assumptions within their current policy scenarios provided to government, and that they're not aware of the fact that these kind of make-believe technologies are embedded in what governments are currently pledging to do. And I think, so my question is, you know, what can scientists do to make that clearer, and why is it that, you know, politicians are constantly hiding behind these scenarios?
So thank you, and to yourself now, Claire, yeah, great. So thank you so much for the minute, and everyone's working to it.
My name is Sagar. So Mr. Gardner, you were saying earlier about no Tories. The big problem for me is that out of this room, just like every other conference I've been to, there's only 5% who look like me. There's only 5% who are of ethnic colour. So I am representing the global south, even on the board and bred in the UK. Now, if we had some people, not just generically saying you're Africa, if we had people from Afghanistan, Iraq, why do I say those countries? Because those are the countries where most of the resources come from. Yes, so we go in, we just invite ourselves into those countries. We bomb them, we take all the resources, we bring them back. And the resources we bring back are the minerals, not just for the mid-16s and 17s, not just for the wind turbines and solar panels, but for many other things as well. So my question to the gentleman from War on Work, and also to Mr. Gardner and anyone else who can answer, is that if we had these people from the global south in this room, then they might be able to give us their own story of what is climate change in the global south. We are contributing it to ourselves deliberately and naively by actually asking for renewable energy because those minerals are raised from those countries. And that's the reality of the check. Thank you. And the war planes contribute to that. That's how we get the minerals. Thank you. Anyone can answer that, please?
Thank you.
Recognising that the writing's on the wall for fossil fuel and cars, for example, and that's all true, but I think we should never lose touch with the idea that if we're going to win on this, the most important issue of this century, we're going to rely mainly on ourselves and on the campaigns which are in progress. For example, against fracking. I mean, whatever the company says, Curly Middleton in Yorkshire, it's because of the campaigning that they pulled out of there, at least for now. Yeah. And whatever Quadrilla would say when it comes to it, it'll be because of the campaigning at Preston New Road if they pull out of there and we manage to stop fracking in the good. So that's one very important thing. And then just a question for Barry. If the Labour government comes to power, which I think we all hope will happen, there'll be so many competing priorities, you know, the government, Tory government and New Labour before it, let's face it, have done so much damage to our society. We all immediately think of 10 priorities, at least for the next government. How is Barry going to help make sure that Jeremy Corbyn not only says he's against fracking, for example, but actually does something about it by bringing in an immediate ban on for oil fracking in this country, and institutes huge subsidies for the renewable industries that we need to replace it. Thank you.
I'm really sorry. I think I will have to stop the discussion from the floor because we've had a number of questions put to our speakers, and otherwise I'm not going to have time to have those questions addressed. So I'm going to invite, let's go in the order that we came in. Joanna, are there any comments that you want to make in response to questions?
The simulations into the future of how we're going to reach net zero includes what are called negative emissions, so extracting CO2 out of the air somehow or other. This is partly because it's difficult to get renewables in enough quantity, but it's also because there's some things that it appears just can't be dealt with, at least with the technology we've got at the moment. For example, aviation. There's lots of ideas about low-carbon aviation fuel. But if you accept there's going to be people flying around, then you need somebody else sucking it out of the atmosphere. I'm not sure I'd accept that it's hidden. I don't think it's necessarily hidden. It's certainly included in all the scenarios that need to get to net zero. There's two ways of, as I proposed, that this might happen. One is essentially carbon capture from big industrial plants. So you've got your power supply that's producing the carbon, and you have some mechanisms whereby it's sucked. And you may have heard about a big project that the government was running out in the northeast to look into the technologies involved in this, and they pulled the money from that, so it stopped. There's projects in Norway, our colleague over here may be able to tell us about, where it's actually implemented, but actually, as I understand it, the quantity, the actual scale that would be needed is just not enough at the moment. The other method, which is what was referred to at the back, is using bioenergy and carbon capture. So you burn some biomass matter, and then you absorb the carbon, and you bury it somehow. There's all sorts of issues around that, partly to do with the use of land that could have been used for food, and all those sorts of issues. And I think it's not at all demonstrated that it's actually going to work in a sensible sort of way at all. So I'm very worried about that. Bioenergy, carbon capture and storage. So there are a lot of questions around negative emissions, and it's a real big concern. And the main thing would be, let's get a load of new clever innovators and technologies thinking about how these things can be done. Firstly, how to get more renewable energy. I've been banging about geoengineering in general, but I won't. But if anybody wants to talk about that, I think it's completely bananas. So.
Thank you. Alfred? Thank you so much. Okay, first, just on the poll and stuff, and maybe something for Barry to think about in terms of. I mean, one of the reasons why we're in this problem, actually, is not about the global north telling the global south what to do in terms of Copenhagen. It's the fact that the global north didn't want to do its fair share. You have a problem with the global commons. What you would do is say, this is the action we need. Who's responsible? Share it. Make it legally binding. It's top down. Everybody does it. What happened was we dismantled the climate framework. We said, do what you can, when you want, how you want, which is why we're heading towards 7 degrees warming of the planet, why these trigger points aren't happening, why the facilitative dialogue this year will not lead to an increase in ambition, why actually more scientists are talking about that 1.5 will have gone by the time the midterm review in 2023 takes place. So this is the reality of a weak and ineffectual climate architecture that we've got. And I think it speaks also to the reason why, partly it was polarized, I mean, why we got into that particular situation. And a lot to do was actually not about Trump, it was actually about Obama. It was about protecting the economic interests. Jonathan Pershing, that Barry mentioned, I also heard him speak, and he said in the climate negotiations, the one thing that's not up for negotiation is the American way of life. And the American way of life is the life that is sacrificing the people around the rest of the world. And that is the the conflict that fundamentally is at play in terms of the climate crisis. But I totally agree with the comrade at the back, we need to decolonise the movement. That's part of what many of us are trying to do, situate and make sure the accountability comes from the global south. And there are incredible movements in the global south around climate justice, and we need to align and stand with them. On the idea of climate change happening to people, absolutely. Look, many of us have fought long and hard that the answer to the saying to workers in the fossil fuel industry, simply give up, like a lot of mainstream environmentalists do, doesn't answer the question of both inequality or good union jobs. Most of the renewable jobs that are happening, even in Germany, are non-unionised, they're low pay, they don't have the same security. What we need, as you absolutely said, we need a proper programme, a programme that actually answers the social inequalities of society. So in the UK, that means retrofitting every house. It means warm homes for people. It means community-owned energy. You can actually start to have real good union jobs, but controlled by the public, controlled by our local state, by local communities. The idea that the private sector is going to step in and lead the way, I don't think is realistic, particularly in terms of the time frame that's needed. It needs the governments to act. I'm just going to add one last point, which was... Oh, on the net zero. Sorry, just on net zero. Look, this is a crackpot idea, right? And it's in there again, because the net zero basically says you can pollute as much as you want as long as at some point we come back down. But we all know that just at 1 degree what's happening around the world. Nobody can predict what happens when you try and turn back the temperature. What will happen? Can we do it? What will what we've triggered and the cycles that will have changed in terms around globally? So I think there's a real concern about what's actually in, if we say that the Paris negotiations and what was agreed in Paris is the framework which guides our climate policy, there are real problems in that. On net zero, on a weak and ineffectual agreement, on the fact that actually there's no binding targets in there's no legal framework in there, it's simply aspirational. And I think the Labour government actually, when it comes into power, should really seriously look at that and then say, we can lead this. We can show there's a different way to do climate change, which is about tackling inequality and bringing social justice globally.
Sarah has forfeited to try and hold her coat and manage this time. But just in lieu of Sarah speaking, I just wanted to make one comment about unionisation and in about those sectors, renewable industry that we mentioned before that are unionised. I would just like us to remember within the trade union movement, it isn't, employers never gave us, sectors of industry never gave us good trade union organisation. In lieu of Sarah speaking, I want to remind us how we actually have achieved good trade union organisation in defending terms and conditions. And I want to point in the direction of Sarah's union. When you saw those young McDonald's workers getting themselves organised, starting to recruit to the union and be willing to stand up for their rights and be willing to take the action that builds a strong union, you need to shift the debate a little bit in the trade union movement. But somehow we have sectors that have good trade union organisation and are fixed and static, and sectors which don't. In the sectors which have good union organisation, we fought for it. And it's constantly under threat. For those of us who work in industries like mine, I'm a teacher, we know our good trade union organisation and the jobs that are reflected is constantly under threat. So I also want to salute the UCU workers who have been on strike, the teachers, the professors, the lecturers have been on strike in the last few weeks, like Joanna here, because that is how we defend and it's a good job. And fight for our rights, and that goes right across the board. And I think we do need to shift the debate in the trade union movement that recognises that we need to do that rather than simply rely on some kind of sector vision of what is a good trade union, organisation. I'm going to introduce Barry. I'm going to say one more thing to politely engage with Barry's comments earlier about a lack of Conservative voters in the room. I don't feel too bad about that, I have to say. However, Barry disagrees with me. What I think is crucial, though, is yes, we want to win the debate in society. We want to win the debate in the trade union movement. And many in our own ranks are still not yet convinced that it isn't jobs versus the environment. I think that's how we see our task The more we have united on that question, the stronger will be our capacity to win the argument in wider society and drag some of those Conservative voters with us, or not, as the case may be. Barry, you have the floor.
Suzanne, thanks very much. I totally agree that the only way in which working people have ever and will ever secure their rights is by organised labour and free collective bargaining. And it is absolutely, I was in the trade union movement before I ever joined the Labour Party. I was organising in my union before I ever joined the Labour Party. And it is absolutely at the foundation of what I believe is the way in which we go forward. So, my comments about needing a few more Tories in the room were simply to illustrate that it's very easy to have a dialogue with ourselves. We need to be having a dialogue with the people who actually, not just that they're not listening to us, they don't want to engage. And we have to have that dialogue. And actually, politics is precisely about having such a dialogue, because it's how you engage with people and by rational and reasonable argument persuade them that actually there's a better way of doing things. And not just that it suits you, but that it suits all of us. Let me turn to the points that were made, and forgive me if I don't answer every specific point, but I'll try and address the ones that were specifically addressed to me. First of all, Andres, thank you for the work that you are doing in Norway. It has been so inspirational to see the way in which Norway as a country has approached this whole area. You've done what we should have been doing in the 1970s, when we had our oil boom and all of that. You exploit your oil, but you've turned it into a sovereign wealth fund, and you've used it in many, many ways for good around the world, and you've been conscious that it is a diminishing asset that your country has, and you're focused on the transition. So whilst you're contributing to the problem, and I don't let you off the hook for that as a country, you are contributing to the problem, but you're mindful of it, and you're actually seeking a way through, and you're using the sovereign wealth fund that you have actually to improve the lives of people around the world. On the Zero Carbon Britain, sorry, step up there, and thank you again for the work that you do, and talking about the Polish COP. The Polish COP is absolutely critical. I think I probably would say Paris was a greater initial point, but as you said, the contributions that were offered at Paris are not enough. My fear is that when the ratcheting begins, we're seeing countries who have not even put in place a program to deliver on their initial nationally determined contributions, and therefore they are going to look at the whole process of ratcheting as a step too far. It is not helped by the fact that the COP is being held in Poland, because that means that the presidency of the COP is actually out of sync with what the COP is supposed to be achieving, and that is a huge problem for us. And it means that we really do need to engage in a very, very positive way to try and make a comeback. The third point about negative emissions, and it was a very good point made, I think, by a gentleman at the back of the room. There is one machine, and I'm not talking about CCS, which is absolutely essential for negative emissions. It has the best record of any of extracting CO2 emissions from the atmosphere. It has huge environmental benefits, and it's called a tree. And unfortunately, what we've seen coming out of Brazil in the past
month, and the failure to properly implement the current volatile is really devastating, because there was a period where the rate of deforestation in Brazil was declining. Unfortunately, that is no longer the case. It is now increasing again. And that is the biggest negative emission sink that we can hope for in this world, that is being reduced daily. And that is affecting not just the emissions, but of course it affects the climate and the weather pattern in Latin America. It also then means that the whole of the agricultural system in Latin America and the rainfall patterns, remember these are called rainforests, that's what they produce rain, and that also means that the agricultural system in Latin America is being thrown out. So it's a huge problem, but it is also, and we must understand this, if we are going to see net zero, and I totally disagree with the way in which net zero was characterized by us, it's not about letting emissions rip and then trying to pull them back again. What it's doing is saying that in each year as you go along, what we must be doing is trying to ensure that there is a net zero of emissions in the atmosphere. It doesn't matter how you do that, what matters is that you do that, but it's not about letting it rip and then say once it's ripped, and pull it back. So then to go on to the fourth point, which was the gentleman talked about the need to have a greater voice for ethnic minorities in this room. Actually, you're at a disadvantage, so because you're at the back of the room and you're looking at the back of people's heads. I'm at the front of the room looking out at actually what is certainly not even balanced, but it is a very good mixture of different ethnicities and that is a really positive thing. But the essential point that you were making about the way in which conflict and climate change have come together is an absolutely welcome point. I hope, though, that you're not engaged in the council despair, because you seem to suggest that renewable minerals, coal town, the production of batteries and so on mobile phones, and that all of that could only be achieved by conflict and by the ritual going in and plundering to get those minerals. It must be a just transition. And of course that means, and here it again connects very much with both parts of my brief and the work that we're doing at the moment to try and ensure that we get far better just trading relationships and just trading agreements. And what I said earlier about the work that we've been doing with War on Want and the Global Justice Movement and the Trade Justice Movement, and fundamentally about creating the situation where we can tackle all the things that we need for the renewable sector for a just transition, but to do it in a just way. And finally, the question that the lady put up front about priorities. I can give you an absolute assurance that it will be a priority if I am fortunate enough to be in government. I don't ever want to be in power, I want to be in government. But if I ever am fortunate enough to be a minister in a general cabinet, I can assure you that that ban on fracking will be my top priority. But I want to say this. I think it was Nine Bevan who said that the language of socialism is priorities, and we have to understand that this whole issue of environmental sustainability, of climate action, is not a separate priority. It is absolutely what undergirds all of our priorities to create a just society, and that is why I believe it's only through a democratic socialist model